strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Is this okay? I'm very nervous standing here. I've been coming to this church for 30 years of Mother's Day services, and I've been a mother myself for the past 10 years. And so when I was asked to speak today, I was like, what do you speak about like on Mother's Day? But I believe the word that God has given me for today, it's not for mothers, it's for us. Because I know that I wouldn't have been here if it wasn't for my mother. So, Lorraine Wagner, I thank you and I honor you for the mother that you've been. I'm going to try not to cry, but I have been known to shed a tear or two, Brother Daryl. I'm trying here very hard. But it's not sad tears, it's happy tears. Okay, but Lord, please help me. So what I have to say and what God has laid in my heart is not for mothers, it's for all of us. I am standing here not because I have arrived or not because I'm qualified, but because of who He is and what He's done in my life. I'm a mother, I'm a wife. My husband is somewhere here, Stuart. And so I trust that you would, this message would touch your heart as it has touched mine, as it would challenge you as it continues to challenge me. So, it's always quiet when the preachers have a title. So I also have a title today. Ooh, bear with me. So, there was more that I wanted to say, but I can't remember. I've got the word intro here, but this morning Luca asked me, Mommy, why are you going to preach? So I said, I don't know, baby. Why did they choose you? I still don't know. But the Lord knows. Turn with me to Matthew 13, verse 44. As we turn to Matthew 13, verse 44, it's... We like Matthew, I like Matthew, and Matthew is full of red, and red in some Bibles is Jesus and Jesus' words. I get excited when it's Jesus' words because I feel like, oh, this is actually Jesus, like He actually spoke here. I was going to ask Stuart to open in prayer, but I think Pastor Adrian has covered me. I think I'm sufficiently covered, so you're relieved of that duty, Stu. So let's read Matthew 13, verse 44 together. You can follow in your Bibles, and I'm going to read from the NLT version. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that a man discovered hidden in a field. In his excitement, he hid it again and sold everything he owned to get enough money to buy the field. So this is a parable shared by Jesus, a one-verse parable. He told many. And in Matthew chapter 13, he was explaining to the disciples and those around him what the kingdom of heaven is. In Matthew, that refers to the kingdom of heaven, but it's the same as saying the kingdom of God or the kingdom of Christ. So he's referring to, he's explaining, using a parable to explain to his disciples what the kingdom of heaven is like. And in this specific parable, he's explaining what the worth of the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God is. And so let's just break it down. Picture this with me. So a man finds his treasure in a field. I like telling stories. So this man finds a treasure in the field. He's walking or moving around the field. He doesn't know. He doesn't know he's going to find the treasure. He doesn't know it's there. It's hidden. We don't know what he's doing in the field. He doesn't own the field. We know that. Is he working in the field? Is he passing by in the field? But nonetheless, he finds a treasure, a hidden treasure. It doesn't belong to him. We don't know what the treasure is. But this man immediately knows that this treasure is valuable, that there is worth to this treasure. And finding this treasure was a surprise to him. But despite that, he knew that it was valuable, and it brought him immense joy. And after finding this treasure, he probably laid awake at night thinking, oh, I found something. So you would wonder, why is there even treasure in the field? But back in the day, back in those dummy 1,000 years or now, back in those times, in Bible study we laugh because we always like laughing about timelines and stuff, but that time, there was no retirement annuity, there was no ETFs and stocks, exchanges and unit trusts, and so people would bury their treasure or bury what they have in the, there was no banks, there was no, what else do we have to put our treasure? There was none of that. They buried the treasure in the ground. And normally they would bury their treasure in the field that they owned for maybe generations in the future to find their treasure and their wealth. And that explains why there was things in the treasure. We don't do that anymore in this world, but that's what was happening. And so after laying, maybe thinking about it and wondering what should I do, he came to a very logical conclusion that he considered the cost of, he considered the cost and he sold everything he had, his possessions. We don't know what that possessions is, but this word says that he sold everything he owned, his house, his cattle, his sheep, I don't know, everything he had, he sold. And he took that money from the sale and he then laid claim to the treasure. The man joyfully gave up everything he had to lay claim to this treasure. He had to give up. He had to sell everything to get the treasure. Not only a sticky, not only 70%, not only his house, everything to get the treasure. He was confident that the treasure in the field was worth more, far more, than everything he owned combined. So what is this parable about? This parable is about the priceless value of the kingdom of God and the worth of the kingdom of God. The priceless, immeasurable value of God's kingdom. What God has to offer is the treasure. The kingdom of God is the treasure. And a relationship with God is the most valuable thing. The kingdom of God is filled with peace, love, forgiveness, freedom, joy. I can go on and I can go on. And this is the treasure. So what is our appropriate response to this treasure? Because this treasure is available to us. The kingdom of God is available to us. What is our appropriate response? Turn with me to Romans 12, chapter 1. And Paul is telling us what our appropriate response is. We were introduced to Paul this past week in our Bible study. Okay, we know Paul, but I mean, in the Bible study context, those who go to Bible study, you know what I'm talking about. In Acts chapter 7, Saul is introduced when Stephen was martyred. Remember, Saul is standing there keeping the coats of those people that martyred him. And Paul comes with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And Saul comes with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and he's transformed. And he pens so many letters in the New Testament, and Romans is but one of them. So read with me, Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Some translations will say that this is your spiritual act of worship. Or some translations will say this is your reasonable service. Verse 2, don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing. So this parable and Paul is a call for us to desire the kingdom of God above all else. The emphasis here is not what we give up, but the emphasis is on the surpassing value of what being offered, of what God is offering us. But on the surpassing value of what is being offered by God in contrast to what we have here in this life. Is Jesus saying we must sell everything? No, maybe, maybe not. What he is saying, however, is that nothing compares to the value of the new life that King Jesus wants to give us. That this life in him is worth more. That we shouldn't love anything or anyone else more than the King. And I'm speaking to my own heart as I'm speaking to you. We should be willing to give up everything for him, because knowing him is worth more than anything. So this man could have just closed up the treasure after finding it, find the treasure, like, oh, and then just closed it. And he could have just gone about and carried on with his day, could have kept all his possessions and just gone on with his life. As we sit here, each of us are on different paths, we are in different seasons, we are in different phases of our lives, as referred to earlier. And this parable may resonate with you. Some of us have found the treasure. We can remember a day where we believed in Christ and we made a decision for him. But we buried that treasure. We left it in the ground. We left it there. Because when we considered what we have in this life versus the treasure didn't seem worth it. And the once upon a time joy that we felt is now replaced with restlessness, an uneasiness, a strife, as our flesh resists the pull of the Holy Spirit, and we do not feel the joy that is available to us. So why do we struggle? What keeps us from surrendering? Paul in Romans 1 says, I plead with you, give your bodies as a living sacrifice, in some translations. This is your acceptable worship. In some translations will say, in light of God's mercy, give your bodies as a living sacrifice. In Luke 14:33, Jesus reminds us, you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. And in Matthew 16, verse 24, this is reiterated, where Jesus says to his disciples, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. In Matthew 6, verse 33, I have to stop myself from putting the whole Bible in my sermon. It's due to cut some stuff. But okay. Seek the kingdom of God above all else, and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. When we hear these words, we become uncomfortable, We start to withdraw emotionally. We think, if I give up, if I have to give up all of this for God, my fun will dissipate. That I'm going to have to give up my dreams, I have to give up my hopes, I have to give up the best things in life. We begin transactions in our mind and we start bargaining with God. We start bargaining with the great I am, the creator. And we're saying, ach, Lord, anything but my girlfriend, anything but my finances, anything but my career, anything but my comforts. Not this, Lord. Surely not that, Lord. Not my children, Lord. And so we focus on what we're going to lose. We think we're going to lose our dreams, and we think we're going to lose our hopes and our happiness. And we settle for a half-hearted, mediocre Christianity when the truth of His word promises us everything we need. We ought to not be focusing on what we're going to lose, but what we're going to gain. And what we are trading. We are trading death for eternal life. We are trading sin for salvation. We are trading hell for heaven and strife for peace. And Paul reiterates just a way of his thought about this. In Philippians 3 verse 7 he says, I once thought these things were valuable, all this stuff about Paul. We know about Paul, eh? But I now consider them all worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For His sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ and become one with Him. I no longer count on my own righteousness, obeying through the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with Himself depends on faith. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised Him from the dead. I want to suffer with Him, sharing in His grace, so that one way or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. So here again, it's total commitment. It's total surrender. Our will aligned and our motives ought to be aligned with His. But why do we not give total commitment? And why do we not have total surrender? Do we not know the worth? We spoke about His, we sang about His worth today. Do we not know who God is? Do we not know what He's done for us? Allow me to remind us what He's done. And the words of the songs have so beautifully just encapsulated what He's done for us. That He has invited us to come to Him as sinners, as guilty sinners. He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and made us clean. Jesus died and He rose 3 days later. And we are alive in Him. And He invites us to be His children. He adopts us to be His children in His kingdom so that we can spend eternity with Him. Eternity with Him. Let that sink in. He's not a God that would withhold anything from us. And let me just remind us, I know, Pastor, this is your favorite verse. Psalm 84, verse 11. For the Lord God is our sun and shield. He gives us grace and glory. The Lord will withhold no good thing from those who do what is right. O Lord of heaven's armies, what joy for those who trust in You. And so sometimes there's this misunderstanding that God is going to take away all my joy and God is going to withhold all good things from me, when nothing could be further than the truth. We have fear of what we're going to lose and fear over faith. And sometimes sin is what keeps us from total commitment. Withholding everything from him and the sin that we know we ought to get rid of. What does he promise us? He promised us treasures. He has treasures awaiting us, his children, and he's waiting for us to surrender so that he can give us his very best. God wants to give us his best, but we won't let him. We want to hold on to our stuff. In Romans 8:3, Paul reminds us that since he did not even spare his own son, but gave up all for us, won't he also give us everything else? His plans for us are greater than anything that we could conjure up. We are reminded in Corinthians 2, verse 9, that no eye has seen and no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him, and that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Paul reminds us that I am convinced that nothing can separate us, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears today or our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from the love of God. And he has given us so much more. He promises to never leave us, never forsake us. And our treasures are stored up in heaven. And last but not least, he has given us eternal life with him. For those of you who have left or lost loved ones, mothers, who know Christ, they are spending eternity with him. And when we close our eyes, and we heard this week how Stephen fell asleep, and when we fall asleep one day, we will spend eternity with him. In heaven with him, a new body, no more tears, no more sorrow, no more pain, Auntie Girlie, no more arthritis, no more knee pain, nothing. Everlasting joy in heaven. Today, let this be a reminder of this treasure that is worth so much. That God invites us because of his mercy and his grace. He invites us into this kingdom so that we can spend eternity with him. Let we be reminded of the complete work of Jesus Christ on the cross, and of our Lord's unfailing goodness. Amen. Now I will ask. Sorry, I just ended like that. Wait, quickly. So as we hear this word, and as we are reminded, and as we are challenged, for some of us, as we're sitting in this church this morning, for some of us, these truths from God's word, because I didn't make up anything, I promise you. These truths from God's word confirms your life, confirms your theology of what you've known to be true. As I look across this room, there are women and men of God that have taken up the cross. So we know about Paul is an example in the Bible, and David is an example in the Bible, and even as you're sitting in this church today, there are examples of the Bible. There are people who have counted the cost and considered it worthy. Hands up if you're serving the Lord for 20 years, 30 years. Hands up. And you've counted the cost, right? Would you do it again? Is he worthy? Worthy of everything else? So don't take my word for it. We have men and women who've counted the cost, and it's worth it. So if in your life you've taken that treasure at some point and you've buried it back into the ground, and for whatever reason it's stopping you from giving total commitment, I trust that today you would be reminded of the everlasting peace, love, and joy that God has promised us. Not in our own strength, because it's literally impossible to do it in your own strength, But by his power and the Holy Spirit living in us, he is able to do that. Less of us and more of him. Amen. Brother Len, can I ask you to pray, please? Thank you.
Them, and it's up to me and you.